Thank you very much. Thank you. And no, I'm sorry, I don't have enough for everybody. That's all that's keeping me going. I've been going since 4:30 this morning. But as Richard said, thank you very much for coming out tonight, chilly night, before the snow flies, Snowmageddon 3, whatever my industry is hyping it as now. You get tired of that? I get tired of it, right? It's like, it drives me crazy. It's New England, it's winter, it snows, right? Do you think that they go through, they don't hype this in Montpelier, Vermont, you know? It's like, oh, 6 inches, we got off easy. Anyway, thank you very much for coming out. So here's what I'd like to do. I thought I'd first tell you how my book came to be, New England Notebook, and then I'd like to share with you some of my favorite stories from the book, and then I'd be happy to take some questions, and then I frankly would be even happier to sell you a book. So how the book came to be, you know, I've been reporting around New England for Chronicle for, it'll be going on 18 years next year, and every time I've come back from shooting a story for Chronicle, driven back from wherever we are, northern Maine, central Vermont, the Cape and the Islands, I've always felt like, I've known because of the talented people I work with, that we have great stuff for the half hour, not the half hour, the 15 minutes that's Chronicle. That's a dirty little secret, right? You think of it as a half hour, it's really 15 minutes. The other 15 minutes is the stuff that keeps Chronicle on the air. So in 15 minutes, we go away, we shoot for 4 days, 5 days sometimes. We come back with about 2.5 hours worth of material. You can imagine there's just so much you can shoehorn into 15 minutes. So over the years, right, I'd be driving back from all these places, and over the years, I would watch these piles of stuff pile up in my office from stuff that just never made it on to the air, because there's no room for it. And it started to really frustrate me, because it's great stuff. But there's just so much you can do in 15 minutes. And a lot of this stuff needed a little bit longer explanation, exposition, narrative. I started to become, about 10 years ago, really intent on finding a way for this stuff to get home, right? So that's when I hit on the idea for the book. So really what this book is, it's a lovely little orphanage for all these homeless little stories that never made it onto the air. See what you're supporting? So people have asked me as well over the years, both in relation to my reporting for Chronicle and the book, if I have a favorite story, right, that I've ever done. And I'm always happy to say, not only do I have a favorite story, but I can sum it up in not just 4 sentences, not even 4 words, 4 letters. F-R-E-D. Anybody ever hear of Fred Tuttle? I heard somebody over here when I, right? Fred Tuttle, yeah. Now, if we were in Montpelier, Vermont, every hand, never mind every hand in the room, there would be just sort of this lovely ripple of knowing laughter and fondness and affection, as if we were talking about a favorite uncle, a favorite relative. That's how Vermonters see Fred Tuttle. Fred Tuttle, if you don't know, is Vermont's most beloved folk hero. He is Vermont's most famous former dairy farmer. Now, that may not sound like much, but in a state that counted more cows than people till the 1960s, it's a big deal to be the most famous former dairy farmer. But it wasn't dairy farming that drew us up to Tunbridge, Vermont, to meet Fred Tuttle. Because Fred Tuttle is also arguably America's most unlikely movie star. Does he look like a movie star? Perhaps if he was in costume and shooting a movie. But that's all Fred Tuttle ever wore. The trademark Carter's blue jean coveralls, the blue hat that said Fred, I think so he could find it wherever it was. And it must have been chilly that day, because when it got cold, he broke out that sort of maroon button-up jacket, wore that no matter, it could be 20 below after that. That's what he wore, no gloves. But it wasn't being a dairy farmer that drew us up to Tunbridge, Vermont, to do a story about Fred Tuttle originally. It was the fact that he had become a movie star. Now, you might wonder how. Well, it had to do with who his neighbor was, frankly. At this point in Fred's life, in the late 80s, very early 90s, Fred Tuttle had a host of health problems that had forced him to stop farming. He had terrible arthritis in both hips. He had a bum knee. He had bad eyesight, bad hearing, bad heart. When he talked, he sounded like he had a mouthful of marbles. Other than that, he was an Adonis. But at this point in his life, he couldn't farm anymore. Had to sell off his beloved herd of jerseys. Very sad day for Fred Tuttle. And so he had a neighbor who's watching all this develop. His neighbor was a guy named John O'Brien. Very bright guy, grew up in Tunbridge, went to Harvard, came back after graduating from Harvard to help run his mom's dairy sheep farm. Fred had the dairy farm. To help run his mom's sheep farm. Now, he had a particular passion, particular interest, John O'Brien did. Can anybody tell what, see what he's holding in his hand? It's a camera. It's a camera. It's a movie camera. John O'Brien had a love for making movies, but a very particular, unique kind of movie making, the likes of which I've never heard anybody else anywhere doing. He calls it community cinema. Think of community theater, but for movies. In other words, amateurs, never used professional actors, real people. He would write to a real story that was affecting real people, friends, neighbors, relatives, and he would craft a story around it, make a movie around it. So he's watching his neighbor, Fred Tuttle, who has a host of all these health problems, can't farm. And he's realizing that there's a great character here to craft a movie around. He says, well, what's the narrative? Well, here's this guy, former dairy farmer, who needs a job. He needs a job that doesn't require any heavy lifting. He needs a job that doesn't require any formal education. He needs more than anything else a job that comes with absolutely blue chip health care. So he thought of the perfect job in the movie. All Fred Tuttle has to do is get elected to Congress. Right? Not a lot of heavy lifting lately. And I mean that in the most bipartisan way. So he crafts this movie around Fred Tuttle running for Congress. Okay? By the way, best political slogan. Anybody else love politics here? I'm a big political junkie. Best political slogan I've ever heard of. So in the movie, Fred Tuttle's running for Congress. The slogan of their campaign in the movie was, I've spent my whole life in the barn. Now, I just want to spend a little time in the house. That's good, huh? I told you, smart guy. Smart guy, John O'Brien, went to Harvard. So in the movie, he runs for Congress, and he wins. He wins, yeah, look at him. Fred Tuttle goes to Washington, and he wins. And the movie was a huge hit. Highest grossing film in Vermont's history. Huge hit. Fred Tuttle becomes a star. He was everywhere. He was on Leno, when there was a Leno. He was on Leno. He was the toast of Hollywood. Fred Tuttle from Tunbridge, Vermont, right? And it was great. It was fun. We went up. We did two stories on him over a couple of years there in 95 when it came out. It was great. It was fun. And you know what? If that's all that had ever happened in the Fred Tuttle story, that alone, it would have been great. Everybody had a great time. He was a lot of fun to hang out with. It was just a lot of fun. But here's the thing. A little reinforcement. The Fred Tuttle story had a second act that unfolded for real, not in a movie. And I've always contended, what happened next, the arc of the Fred Tuttle story, became so unbelievable that if you took what happened next to 10 real-life Hollywood screenwriters, possibly all 10, at least 9, would have dismissed it outright as being too unbelievable. Nobody's going to believe this. So here's what happened. In 1998, 3 years after the movie's release, Vermont senior senator, Democrat Patrick Leahy, is up for re-election. And John O'Brien, we've already established, bright guy, has a great idea. You see where this is going, right? Yeah. Why don't we run Fred for real this time? They figured there's no danger of unseating Pat Leahy, who they all liked, and they could get great publicity for the movie. Well, I'm here to tell you that turned out to be more wildly true than either one of these guys ever could have imagined. So here's what happens. They take out nomination papers as a Republican for Fred to run for the U.S. Senate. He draws a primary opponent, a guy by the name of Jack McMullen. Now, Jack McMullen was a wealthy Massachusetts businessman who moved over the border to southern Vermont because I think he scoped out what he thought would be an easy race. I don't know what he thought his political future was in Vermont, but he thought that this might be a real easy race to win. Thing is, Vermonters, they value authenticity quite a bit. I don't have a picture of Jack McMullen. I invite you to imagine Snidely Whiplash. He did have a mustache, not black. But he didn't look, perhaps, like the most quintessential Vermonter, as opposed to Fred Tuttle. They had one single debate. And we've established that I'm a bit of a political joke. I love political debates. I watch tapes of political debates, wherever I can find them, like some people watch soaps. So I love political debates. And I've read political debate transcripts. I want to read you what is now, I mean, I haven't read all of Lincoln Douglas, but I want to read you what is now my favorite debate exchange in American political history. And I think this exchange is actually perhaps unmatched in the annals of American political history. I think you'll see why. It's only three lines. It happened in late fall, late October, 1998, in Burlington, Vermont, at the offices of VPR, Vermont Public Radio. And this is the actual debate exchange. Fred, this is a milk production question, Jack. How many teats does a Holstein have and how many does a Jersey have? McMullen, how many what, Fred? Fred, teats, Jack, teats. How many teats does a damn cow have? You know, we're city folk by and large, and yet I suspect that most of us in this room know that the correct answer is FOA. Well, it eluded Flatlander Jack McMullen, who promptly mispronounced 8 of the 10 Vermont town names that Fred put to him. Either way, authenticity went out the window. The case seems to have been made. And on primary day, 1998, Fred Herman Tuttle became the official Republican nominee for the U.S. Senate from the state of Vermont. Now, the Vermont State Republican Party was starting to look with a little bit of concern at their newly minted nominee, especially after his first press conference, when he was asked about his opponent, Democrat Patrick Leahy, and Fred's answer was, "Well, I like Leahy, I'm sure he's gonna win." Not what the state GOP was looking for. Actually, there's a good reason for Fred to like Leahy. You know, Fred's mother grew up in Reigate, Vermont. Pat Leahy's mother grew up in Reigate, Vermont. And in a state like Vermont, which has just over 650,000 people, that practically made Fred Tuttle and Pat Leahy brothers. So there was a reason why he liked Leahy. And that's what he said. He added, "But if you want to see me go to Washington, why don't you go buy my movie?" So I said to my boss about this time, I said, "Do you see what is going on with Fred Tuttle?" And he said, "Yeah." I said, "I think I should go back up and spend a few days on the campaign trail with him. What do you think?" And he said, "How soon do you think you can get up there?" So a couple of days later, I was up in Tunbridge, Vermont, and I got up there about 8 o'clock. I knocked on the front door. Fred's second wife, Dottie, piece of work. she's an interesting character. she answered the door. I said, Dottie, good to see you. I said, what is going on with this Senate thing? This is wild. And she said, first words out of her mouth, I quote verbatim, well, I won't vote for him, that's for sure. I said, what? She said, he's not qualified and he knows it. So we went off and we went to the first campaign event of the day. It was at a little elementary school in Tunbridge. It was a class of about 21, 22 kids, fifth grade class, so 10-year-olds. The teacher had told us that we might want to be in the class when Fred comes in. She said, you might want to get a picture of this. And when we got there and we're waiting for Fred and we saw Fred walk in, we understood why. Every single kid in the class, boys and girls, every single one of them was wearing Fred's trademark blue jean coveralls. Possibly the cutest thing I've ever seen in my life. And Fred walked in and we had the camera and we walked in and just like that, he tilted that hat back off his head and he rubbed his stubble chin. He said, well, look at that. By Jesus, don't you know? And he sat down and the kids proceeded to have a little Q&A with the candidate. I raised my hand at one point. I said, Fred, how much money have you spent on your campaign? And he turned to John and he said, John, what would you say? $16? I'd say about $16. You got that extra cheese on that pizza down there in Monroe. And the kids went out to recess, and Fred and I sat down on a couple of those little low desks. You forget how low those desks are. Kids are short. We sat down and had a little chat for the interview for the show, and I said to him, first question, I said, Fred, the history of American politics is littered with things that happened that were completely unexpected. Outcomes that never, ever could have been predicted. What would happen if you actually won? And he said, without missing a beat, well, first thing, my wife, she'll divorce me right off quick. Well, on election day, 1998, November 6th, Fred spared Dottie that particular ordeal. He got 20% of the vote. He also had done something which makes it even remarkable. He got 20%. He also did something else just before Election Day that is unmatched in the history of American senatorial politics that, if did not completely ruin his future with the state Republican Party, well, it did. He endorsed his opponent. He officially endorsed Pat Leahy. He said, well, I'm going to vote for him anyway. Not playing games. So he got 20% of the vote, but he did lose. He did lose to his friend, Pat Leahy, in one of the most remarkable political campaigns in American history. I was sorry to see it end, because I could have kept going up there and spending days with him. I think my boss would have, you know, kept sending me up there. I wish that campaign had gone on for a year and a half. But he lost, and I spoke with Pat Leahy a couple of times in the process of researching my book. By the way, he does an uncanny Fred Tuttle imitation, in addition to his other talents. So I asked him for his recollections of the campaign, and he said, well, I asked him about election night. He said, well, you know, I was in Burlington. And he said, I called Fred as soon as the results came in. It was pretty much called at 7:01. And he said, I called Fred a little after 7 to congratulate him. And I got Dottie on the phone. And she said, he's sound asleep. So he said, I called the next morning, early, farmer's time, 5 a.m., and I got Fred. And I congratulated him, and he said to me, Pat, I'm so glad you won. Because I want to tell you, I had a nightmare last night that I won, and I was hiding out in the barn so no one would find me. But I asked Senator Leahy in the course of our conversation, you know, Vermonters value authenticity. They also value thrift. So As soon as Fred endorsed him, Leahy suspended all his campaigning so as not to spend any more money. And he invited Fred to travel around the state and forego campaign events and go to schools and talk to school kids. And they did. And it was this remarkable, people still remember it. It was like Pat and Fred's excellent adventure. And I asked him about his memory of his recollection of that final period in time. And I want to read you just the end of the chapter on Fred Tuttle. I asked Leahy what he thinks the essence of Fred's unique appeal was. Well, Vermonters heard him, and they knew he was authentic as they come. What you saw and heard was who he was, and what you got, there was no guile whatsoever. He was nice. He was warm. There's a pause on the other end of the line. The easy, self-assured voice of the nation's second most senior senator and chairman of the powerful Senate Judiciary Committee trails off for a moment. At some point before he died, Leahy continues, he told me the last years of his life, riding around the state, meeting school kids, were the happiest years of his life. In 2003, at the age of 84, Fred Tuttle passed away at his home in Tunbridge, Vermont. By Jesus, he was a good one. That's Fred Tuttle. Now, you know, if you watch Chronicle, and I know all of you do, although curiously you're not watching right now. Sorry, I'll give you all a signed note. So, you know that Chronicle is as much about places as it is people, and frequently a whole lot of food, too. Anybody know where this is? Stockbridge. Anybody know who painted that? Norman Rockwell. Exactly. He lived right around the corner, and he painted this scene of Main Street in Stockbridge. That is Norman Rockwell's studio on the grounds of the Norman Rockwell Museum in Stockbridge, Massachusetts, and that is Norman Rockwell at work in his studio on the grounds of the Norman Rockwell Museum in Stockbridge, Massachusetts. Now, in 2009, I went out there, done many, many stories out there. In fact, I'll be out there next week on a story, but I love the Berkshires, and had an opportunity to go out and do a story. There were two 40th anniversaries that intrigued me. One was the 40th anniversary of the release of one of my favorite movies, and I'm sure one of yours, Alice's Restaurant. Bit of a cult movie. And the other was the 40th anniversary of the Norman Rockwell Museum. Now, I was going to go out anyway to do the story about the movie. I probably wouldn't have gone out to do the story on the Norman Rockwell Museum. Just because, you know, there's a lot of institutions that have anniversaries, and that in itself doesn't usually intrigue me. But in this case, I was intrigued because I had an opportunity to do something with one of my favorite Norman Rockwell paintings. Now, we think of Norman Rockwell, I think I speak for everybody, when we think of most of his iconic American paintings. You know, the Four Freedoms, Thanksgiving. What's less well known is that later in his life, Norman Rockwell turned his considerable talents to social issues. And the social issue in America that he was most passionate about and interested in portraying was race in America. In 1967, Life magazine commissioned Rockwell to do the cover for a special issue that they were doing on race in America. This was for a story inside the issue on integration in America. And this is a real scene. Forest Park, Illinois, families of color moving in, 1967. In addition to the reality of the location, you may also know, if you know anything about Norman Rockwell and his painting, that 99% of the people portrayed in his paintings were real people, people who modeled for him. And this painting was no different. Everybody in that painting lived in Stockbridge, Massachusetts, which is where he was when he painted it. And I want to direct your attention to the young African-American gentleman on the far left. His name was Ray Gunn. He was 13 years old. How's that for a name, by the way? Ray Gunn. It took you a minute, didn't it? W-R-A-Y-G-U-N-N. He was 13 years old. His grandfather was friendly with Norman Rockwell. Frequently, when Rockwell was finished painting for the day, he would invite the elder Gunn to over for a drink or two and smoke their pipes. And he must have told him about this painting he was going to be doing. There weren't a lot of families of color in Stockbridge, and so it stood to reason that Grandfather Gunn suggested his grandson Ray, who did pose for the painting when he was 13. Meet Ray Gunn in 2009. Now, he was a delightful guy, interesting guy. He was living in New York. He'd come back to Stockbridge. He had some health problems, wanted to be closer to family. Amateur baseball umpire, has one of the best out calls I've ever seen, and that includes the majors. Interesting guy, and so I wanted to go up because we had an opportunity to talk to him about his connection with this painting. And you know, what was great is that we got to watch him give a tour. He wasn't just visiting here. He actually volunteered and was giving tours. Now, if you've been there, this occupies sort of an entrance way, and you see this right away, this painting. And then you proceed. And so he's talking to these people, and we're shooting it, and he's talking to this group, about 20 people, most from out of state. And he's talking to them about the painting and some of the great details in it, which I love, you know, and he's pointing them out. I mean, the line in the sidewalk that presumably will be crossed, the fact that all of the boys, every one of them, shares an interest in baseball. And I'm waiting. I'm thinking, you're leaving out the best part. And he's done. He's like, you know, he's like, okay, we're going to move on. I said, wait a minute, you're not going to tell them? And then casually over his shoulder, he says, oh, by the way, that's me in the corner. And everyone was like, whoa! And then he talked about it. But here's a funny thing that I remember most from our visit. I asked him in the course of our interview if he'd ever been to Forest Park, Illinois, this place that figured so significantly in his life. And he said, no, I always thought, though, that somehow I would go there. And he said, it's funny you should ask, because just this past summer, so this is 2009, October, in July, he told us, in 2009, he had some family friends in Chicago who invited him out for a visit. And they had tickets to a Cubs game at Wrigley Field. And so he went out, and he was on his way there on the subway, and he missed a stop. He fell asleep, missed the stop. He said, I woke up, I didn't know where I was. I knew that the city was pretty far behind me. I asked this lady, I said, I missed my stop, and she said, don't worry about it. She said, the train's coming into a station right now. Just get out, go around to the inbound side, get off at Belmont, you'll be fine. The train slows down, doors open up, Forest Park. Right? Isn't that wild? So that's Ray Gunn. Now, one more person I want to talk to you about, and then I'm going to end with another place that's special to me. I mean, you know, in addition to Bedford. Lynn Donahue. Nothing special about Lynn Donahue except she's the most inspiring woman I've ever met in my life. She grew up in New Bedford, Massachusetts. New Bedford. Now, I don't know how well you know New Bedford, but tough town, tough port city. I have a particular fondness, always have, and I guess it shows up in the amount of stories I've done that are in old, struggling mill towns, port cities around New England. I have a fondness for cities and towns around New England that have had to struggle, that have had to reinvent themselves to get by. I have the same respect and fondness for people that have done that. Lynn Donahue, in some ways, personifies both. She is the perfect poster child for New Bedford, Massachusetts, because both of them have had to struggle, have faced challenges, and have somehow survived and prospered in their own way. Now, New Bedford in the late 60s, when Lynn Donahue was born, growing up, was even, well, a lot worse off than it is today. New Bedford today, you know, has had First of all, the fishing industry, believe it or not, I mean, it's suffering again, but it came back. In the 60s, it had been in a terrible, terrible dive. And she's growing up. The city had, at one point, it had an almost 40% unemployment rate. It had a crime rate that rivaled Chicago. Terrible scourge of drugs, particularly heroin. Lynn Donahue counted for us 8 former friends that had died to drug overdoses. So this was a tough place to be growing up. And it was tougher for Lynn Donahue. It was tougher for Lynn Donahue because she grew up in a terribly dysfunctional family. Alcoholic, physically abusive father, mother, 5 kids, mother working 2 jobs, basically as a single mom to try to keep it together. She left home at 15, dropped out of school at 16, and by her own account was going nowhere fast. And it's funny, I've always thought it's funny, not ha-ha, funny, more rueful, in the sense of the things that sometimes save people who are falling. Save people who are needing an anchor because they're falling. Sometimes, for some people, it's been another person. Sometimes, for some people, it's been religion. For Lynn Donahue, it was, of all things, a newspaper ad. This is pre-internet. So she saw an ad. This is, let me set the scene, this is the early 1970s now. Period of Title IX. Period when the federal government, I think long overdue, is making an effort legally to level the playing field when it comes to women in competitive sports in public schools. Now, we think of Title IX. Title IX was the most sort of famous example of that effort, but other federal agencies were doing the same thing. And the Department of Labor was doing the same thing when it came to underrepresented fields of work in America. And few fields of work other than fishing and forestry were more underrepresented than the building trades in America. And she saw an ad for a special program that the Department of Labor was offering for women who were interested in a career in the building trades to go through a 6-month training program in masonry. This particular one was to be a bricklayer, a mason. And something spoke to her, and she decided to do it. Now, I became friendly with Lynn over the years, and I love her answer to, I asked her once, what was it about this ad to become a mason that spoke to you? There was nothing, there was no precedent in your family. Nobody was in the building trades. Her father was a bartender. But I would love her answer. She said, you know, my whole childhood was one of instability, change, nothing lasted, everything got busted up. And I thought, maybe if I was able to make something with my hands that lasted, maybe that would feel good. And that's what she did. She went through this program, tended bar to be able to afford gas money, to drive the 20 miles, 3 nights a week to a local community college, 20 miles away. 8 women start out, she's the only one who finishes. She gets her certificate, goes back to New Bedford, goes to the local building agent and says, look, here's my certificate. I'm qualified to be a mason. I want to be sent out for work. He laughed in her face. He said, honey, 1973, he said, honey, suppose I send you out for work now. It was summer. There's work. I mean, I don't know what the hell you're going to run into when you get on a job site. Flash forward for me. What's going to happen in January when the jobs dry up? Every single guy out on those job sites, when 9 projects shrink to 1 or 2, every single guy on those job sites has a brother, a son, cousin, brother-in-law, son-in-law, nephew. They're all cutthroat, protecting their own, looking for work. How do you think that's going to work for you to be out there? Well, she was nothing if not dogged and determined, became the story of her life. She insisted. He said, hey, it's your funeral, honey. He didn't know how nearly prophetic he was. sent her out on a job site. It was a two-story parking garage in New Bedford. Now, the catcalls, the jeering, the inappropriate jokes, the overturned lunch bucket with dead pigeons stuffed back inside, that was the least of it. About 6 weeks in to her first job, she fell 26 feet from an unsecured piece of scaffolding. She punctured a lung, broke two ribs, sprained both wrists, and the doctors wanted her to be off her feet for 6 weeks. 5 days later, she went back to the job site. Now, I've spoken with a couple of guys who worked on that project as part of the research for the book. One of them, love this guy, big, huge Portuguese fellow from Dighton, Mass. And he recalls it this way. He said, when Lynn Donahue got out of her car, and she's all bandaged up, and she's like walking like a penguin, and she's like rolling herself over onto the scaffolding to get back up to exactly where she was working. He said, you know what? The only thing missing was the theme song from Rocky. Well, there were no more overturned lunch pails after that. She determined that she would be the first person on the job site every day and the last person to leave. She, it turns out, had great skill as a mason. In fact, that's her work. She personally relayed the cobblestones in New Bedford's historic Whalingport district. Turns out she was a very skilled mason. And she became one of the best masons on any of these job teams. And about 2 years later, remember the building agent, Honey? Well, he shows up again. And he says, hey, I'm just the messenger. But now the federal government is offering 5 low-interest loans for 5 qualified candidates in the country who want to start their own construction business, women. The building trades were underrepresented. Owning your own construction business, started by a woman that lasted 5 years, was unrepresented. Hadn't been done, ever. There were women who had taken over for husbands, but starting your own business had not been done. They were interested to see if somebody could do that, pull that off. So Lynn Donahue got one of the loans. She started her own company, Argus Construction Company. Turns out that she was just as talented a businesswoman as she was a mason. And Argus Construction Company became one of the most successful construction companies in southeastern Massachusetts. Remember the Fred Tuttle story had an unbelievable second act? Well, the Lynn Donahue story now takes a turn. And for me, I've always felt that it becomes this, I don't know what the word is, you know, it almost like a really heartwarming tale of grace. Because she was so successful. I mean, literally, getting pretty much all the major bids in southeastern Massachusetts, that all those guys that had made her life miserable, all those guys that had treated her like crap, you'll forgive my French, they showed up asking her for a job. They had to. She was getting them all. And you know what she said to every single one of them? You're hired. Not only that, she became the best boss they ever had, the best boss she never had. She learned everybody's name. She learned everybody's kids' names. She remembered their kids' birthdays. She delivered the paycheck every week personally with a handshake and a heartfelt thank you. And my big, tall Portuguese friend in Dighton, the way he puts it is, he said to me, there are a battalion of guys just like me all over southeastern Massachusetts that today would walk through a wall for Lenny Donahue. But it kept going. The construction company was a huge success, and about 5 years later, she sold it because she wanted to give something back. So she started her own foundation called Brick by Brick, which also became the title of her own memoir about her experience, so that she could counsel at-risk teenagers in New Bedford about how to apply a building blueprint concept to their life and stay in school and succeed like she had. She did that, and then she decided she wanted to do something new again. And so she entered college again. Again, she entered college, and now she's finishing up a PhD in education. Lynn Donahue, who was going nowhere fast, is now Dr. Lynn Donahue. I told you, most inspiring woman I've ever met. Now, let's finish up with a place, one of my favorite places in New England, other than Bedford. Now, anybody know where this is? Oh, stop it! Who said that? Who said that? Wow.
What is it?
Pemaquid Point. Now, where's that? Maine. Now, usually I could go for 20 minutes sometimes. People don't get it. Pemaquid Point is one of my favorite places in New England. But it's not because of this particular scene. It's pretty, don't get me wrong. But the lighthouse is run-of-the-mill. I know lighthouses. And it's run-of-the-mill. You know, it's about 29 feet high, standard for now. It's not exceptional, so it's not the lighthouse. You know, you can go down to the water. A lot of people like to take a nice arty photograph with the reflecting tidal pool there of the lighthouse. But it's not the lighthouse. It's not the lighthouse. You know, it's something else. It's that. It's what's behind the lighthouse. The Atlantic Ocean and nothing else. Now, I grew up on the water in Winthrop, Massachusetts, or as I like to refer to it, the little town at the end of runway 32L.
Yeah.
And it's a very noisy, noisy childhood. I wondered for years why everybody screamed. Why, you know, and that, like, you know. So Pemaquid Point sits at the end of one of those, you know, those very singular signature finger peninsulas that stick out, right, coast of Maine. Pemaquid sits at the end of one of those. Sticks out into Muskongas Bay, mid-coast Maine. You go up to Bath, you take a right, you drive down about 21 miles. You get to the town of Bristol. The scrub pines run out of anything to grow in. The rocks run out of room. The ocean rises up, the surf. Next stop, coast of Europe. There's nothing there. Surf's it's too rocky for about 3/4 mile out, so there's no fishing right there, no lobstering. There's no protected inlet. There are no docks, no place to get a cup of chowder. There's no lobster buoys all piled up with nicely colored buoys to take a picture of. You know, there's nothing there. The tour buses don't go down there because there's no place to get a cup of chowder. And that's why I love it, because to me, that's the scene I see in my mind's eye when I think about the rugged and rocky coast of Maine. And I've been there all four seasons of the year. And you know what I love? I love to stand out pretty much down this far on those rocks. I love to watch people come out. They want to get a picture of the lighthouse, right? So they come down, they walk down on the rocks, and they turn their back, and they get that picture of the lighthouse. They stand there for a minute. And then, you know, they casually turn around, and there's an ocean behind them. And then they linger, and usually 20 minutes, half hour later, they're still standing there. It has that effect, you know, that mesmerizing effect. Now, when I did the chapter in the book on Maine, I wanted to consult my favorite Maineologist, Peter Mahigan. Anybody remember Peter?
Oh, yeah.
Peter is a dear friend, mentor of mine at Chronicle, longtime Chronicle reporter. His trademark Chevy, Peter visited every single county in the state of Maine, did countless stories on Maine. Now, Mainers are very protective of their, you know, their being a Mainer, and as opposed to anybody who's a flatlander or from away, and which Peter was. However, I contend that there's more than a few Mainers that would be more than happy to confer honorary native status on Peter Mahigan. That's how he knew Maine. And so I asked him, he had some great stories about Pemaquid, which are in the book. But we used to talk, Peter and I, about Maine. We love to talk about Maine. I love Maine. I spend a lot of time there. And we would love, that was one of our favorite subjects, you know, was to talk about Mainers. What makes Mainers unique and different and Maine stories? And we'd always talk about our favorite Maine kind of idiosyncrasy of Mainer, which is that Mainers don't like generally to talk any more than they have to. Taciturn. Do you know that Maine is the only state in America that borders only one other state? I think Mainers, if they could have their way, they wouldn't border any other state. That would be tough. But they don't like to talk any more than they have to. You know? TMI, right? Too much information. A Mainer will never be accused of TMI. It's never happened. I think there are families in Maine where weeks go by, nobody's talked to each other. They're not upset with each other. They just have nothing to say, and they don't have any real reason to talk. So we would always joke about that. And when we were getting off the phone about when I talked to Peter about the book, I asked him for his favorite anecdote of Maine. I said, I've never asked you, Pete, what's your favorite Mainer anecdote? And he said, this is about 2 years ago, right before the book went to the publisher, and he said, you know, it's funny, Teddy, you should ask, because this just happened recently. So Pete had friends all over Maine. And if he was within 10, 20 miles, he would detour wherever he was and drop in. And such was the case with a particular family up in Cundy's Harbor. He was friendly with a lobstering family up there, and he would drop in frequently when he was up there. And he'd go out lobstering for an hour or so with the elder, and they'd come back in, thaw out, and have an adult beverage or two or three. And he said that he'd been up there recently, and he decided he was nearby Cundy's, and he decided he was going to drop in. And he said he steered the Chevy down to the dock, and he saw the guy's son out putting traps away, and he didn't see the dad. He thought, oh my, oh my. So he got out, he walked up kind of slowly to the son, and he said, Dad okay? And the son said, oh, Dad's fine, Pete. He finally had that eye surgery. He's just recovering down at my brother's place in Bucksport. He's telling Pete the story. He said, well, the doctor told him he wanted him to have a vitrectomy. He wanted him to repair the vitreous nerve in his eye. Thought it would significantly improve his vision. And he says to Pete, well, Pete, Dad's hearing wasn't all that good either. You see where this is going. So he said, Dad went home, and he said, Ma, we got to go down to Boston. Got to go to Mass Eye and Ear. They want to give me a vasectomy. Don't ask me how. They say it's going to make me see better. And it did. But when we were finishing up that conversation, I'm going to leave you with, Pete asked me for my favorite Maine anecdote. And I said, well, you know, it's funny because my favorite Maine anecdote goes right to our favorite Maine quality of not wanting to talk too much. So when I was 20, summer that I was 20, I worked for a summer on Mount Desert Island, Bahaba. And a buddy of mine who I was working with, we had the day off. And another friend of ours who owned a car but had to work that day let us have a car for the day. So we thought, great, we'll drive off the island, we'll get up to some fun. Well, the car broke down, first thing. So we had to push the damn car. And it was hot, it was humid, it was like mid-August, and we're pushing this car. And this was early, the cars were bigger, this was not a compact. And we're pushing the car, and we're pushing the car through the little town of Soamesville. Anybody ever been? Well, Soamesville is beautiful. In fact, little useless factoid for you. Soam Sound is the only natural fjord in North America. But we were not really in a sightseeing mood. So we're pushing the car. And then we saw a sign that said gas station, 1 mile. Great. So we keep pushing the car. And then we saw this little white frame house with a little porch. And a little old Mainer sitting on a rocking chair on the porch with his dog at his feet. It looked like something out of Edward Hopper. And I yelled out at him, I said, excuse me, do you know if there's a mechanic at that gas station? And he said, yes, sir. And I said, thank you. And we kept pushing the car. And about 10 seconds later, I heard a voice behind me. It said, "Won't find him there today, though." No, we wouldn't have. But we pushed the car there anyway, and we got there bright and early the next morning. We left the car, came back, didn't see anybody, heard some clanging in the garage. So we went in, there was a car up on the lift, somebody banging around underneath. I said, "Morning!" And a little head poked under the car. We recognized him immediately, our friend from the porch. I didn't blame him. You know what? You got two strange guys pushing a car down the street. What are you going to do, share the details of your work schedule? You know? That was fine. He fixed the car. All was good. All was great. And so have you been. Thank you very much. Thank you. This is great. Thank you. Thank you. So I'll tell you what. I would be happy to answer any questions. If you have any questions about the book or Chronicle or Maine, although I might refer you to my friend here who seems to know a lot about Maine. So any questions, I'd be happy to do that. And then, as I said, I'm obviously happy if you want to skip that part and we can go right to selling books. any questions? Any questions? Yes, ma'am.
I'm so grateful, and I think we're all very grateful, to have you come here to speak to us.
Oh, thank you.
And we're fans of...
This is why I invite my mother to all my talks.
Well, I just wanted to say, I was hoping you were going to tell that story, because I think that was delightful.
Thank you. You have the book there?
I do.
Oh, that's how you knew it. I don't know. I
haven't quite finished it yet.
God bless you. Thank you very much. Thank you. I appreciate that. I really do. That means a lot to me. Thank you. Yes, sir.
Does Peter still have his old Chevy?
Does Peter still have his old Chevy? Let me put it this way. Peter still owns the Chevy, and the Chevy is still on Peter's property. It has no wheels, so it ain't going anywhere in a hurry. You know, the Chevy doesn't owe anybody anything. You talk about durable. The Chevy, that must have been a good day in Detroit, because the Chevy over the years, let me see if I have the numbers right, I knew them at one time, the Chevy had three rebuilt engines, it went through a dozen sets of tires, and it had, by the end, almost 500,000 miles on it. So it didn't owe anybody anything. But the Chevy is now up on milk crates in Peter's backyard of his summer place in... Situate, so yeah, I know this one. The Chevy is a 69, I think, Chevy Impala. Yeah. Yes. Yes.
So you started in Winthrop and you're here in Bedford tonight. What happened in the middle? How did you find your way from Winthrop to Chronicle?
I do want to get to selling books, you know. Oh, that is just too checkered a past to get into now. But I appreciate the interest. But you know, the long story short, I did. I grew up in Winthrop. I went to college for a couple of years. I dropped out. I moved to New York. I was in theater, both writing and acting, for a number of years, New York and Chicago. I came back. I finished school at Brandeis. I went to graduate school at Brandeis. I went back to New York for a couple of years. And then I ended up coming back here. I had a job offer from Channel 5 to do some... kind of roving correspondent for a show that doesn't exist anymore. It was an hour-long morning live show called Good Day. And I did that, and that led to ultimately staying there full-time to work for Chronicle. And I've never looked back. Miss New York sometimes, but that's the thumbnail version.
Well,
yes.
A storyteller.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
I'm sorry,
what did she say? She said I'm a hell of a storyteller.
Okay.
Janet Langhart.
She was.
Janet Langhart, for those of you who don't know, is a beautiful woman. She was one of the early, maybe even the first hosts of Good Day with a fellow named John, help me out here, somebody.
He did.
Yeah, it'll come to me. Willard? It'll come to me. But anyway, yeah, and then she, many years later, married Maine senator, Republican senator, Cohen. Yeah, Bill Cohen. So, and she's written some books herself. Fascinating lady. Yes. Yes, sir.
Still doing any theater work?
I don't. No. No, I do some writing. For many years, I haven't for several years now, but for a number of years, over the last 10 years, but not for the last few years, I tried to write one short play a year for the Boston Theater Marathon, which is an event every year. It's a great event. They do 50 two-minute plays over the course of 2 days. But that's my involvement with theater. Yeah, yeah. I love the theater. I love the theater. And I have more respect for actors than I can say. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
One of the things I like most about Chronicle is music that is featured during the episodes and at the end of each of it.
Yeah.
Is there any way that it can be made public, like a list of what that music is, or a library, or you know, how we can get copies of that music?
That's a great idea. I've been asked that before. That's a great idea. You know, one thing that mitigates against that changed, and I'm glad that maybe you don't feel you notice it that much, but we certainly do. With the advent of the web and the advent of Chronicle repeating and archiving material on the web, the royalties situation became such that we, in most cases, were unable to use original music a lot anymore. And we rely now on, admittedly, a very extensive, great library, but it's what's referred to in the industry as canned music. It's not stuff that you would recognize, and it's quite good, and it fits our purposes, so I'm glad you feel like you like the music, but believe it or not, and don't get me wrong, it's an outfit in LA that does nothing but, with very talented musicians, create music for us. And shows like us, but in most cases, it wouldn't work to nor would it make a lot of sense to sort of say what the music is, because usually it's track 7 on the landscapes. See, do you know what I mean?
So they're not in CDs that can be purchased.
No. I mean, it's come up before. And there was a period of time where we actually thought about would it be possible to just take the cuts that have aired on a particular popular Main Streets episode and just, I think they just found that legally it was just going to be more trouble than it's worth. But I appreciate that you like the music. It's one of my favorite things is to work on that part of the story. I mean, obviously, you like music as well. Anyone else? Yes, ma'am.
I was thinking that the kind of a job that you have for the last 20 years, that in a very informal, sort of anecdotal way, you get to take the pulse, let's say, of this part of the world that you.
It's a good way of putting it. Yeah.
And I'm wondering if you've seen any difference. I mean, if I think 20 years, obviously pre-911, post-911, and I'm not talking about specifics, but just your sense of
what changes have I seen around New England?
Changes, attitudes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are people more welcoming, less welcoming to you now?
I can't answer. I think it all depends with journalists. It all depends sort of what venue and kind of context you're working in. I think for a lot of news reporters, they absolutely have noticed a sort of chilling effect when it comes to approaching people and when it comes to finding it more difficult in many ways just to physically have access to places where it's not the same as it was. I don't notice the change so much for myself. I mean, there are times when I'm on assignment and have to be in a place like that, and that just becomes part of what you have to deal with, especially when you travel. But for myself, I pride myself on dealing one-on-one with people and being very, upfront and forthright about, I'd love to tell your story. I think there's something here. In fact, I always joke that people sometimes ask me, maybe somebody would have tonight, because it comes up frequently, ask me, how I get my stories. And I always joke that, lots of different ways, some of them very pedestrian. I mean, sometimes I there's just something you got to do because it's a story that's developing and you read about it and whatever. But I love when people get in touch with me, and people do. You know, they call, they write, they in the mail, you know, send me emails, whatever. And they tell me about something. And I love that because 9 times out of 10, when somebody approaches me like that, it's a story that hasn't been done before. But to your point about, you know, have I noticed people and how they react and so forth, I always also say that when I drive around, I notice things. I'm looking. I'm surprised I don't have more dents on my car because I'm constantly noticing things that might be interesting and might make for a good story. And I can't tell you how many people all over New England have opened their back door, front door, side door, and found me standing there and saying, hi, and I introduced myself. And I said, what is that thing in your driveway? And tell me about that. In fact, one of my favorites, speaking of Maine, I was up a couple years ago in Camden, outside of Camden. And I'm driving along and I see this full-scale Sherman tank, World War II vintage Sherman tank in this guy's driveway. And where the turret should be, it's the most gorgeous flowering planter that I've ever seen. I said, okay, hello. So I knocked on the guy's door. The minute I knocked on the door, I thought, maybe that's not such a good idea. And this guy collects tanks. And he was this huge, like Grizzly Adams. But you know what? He was delighted that I stopped and we talked. And that proves to me that, you know, I guess it's just how you approach people. You know? And my approach is, hi, I immediately tell people who I am. I show them my identification. I say I'm a reporter. You don't have to talk to me. But if you can tell me anything about this thing in your backyard, I would love to tell other people about it. And it usually works. Thank God, because otherwise I wouldn't have a job. Anyone else? Yes, Mom. Oh. I told you one question per.
This is a grandmother.
We agreed.
Shayna Seymour, what did she
have? Oh, I love Shayna. What did she have?
Yes.
A darling little girl.
Oh, good.
A beautiful little girl. She had her baby girl in late, mid-December, and she just came back to work 2 weeks ago, and her office is right next to mine, and I was really delighted when she came back, because she is just one of the sunniest, warmest people that I've ever met. She's just a lovely person. But thank you for asking. I'll tell her that. I'll tell her that. Anyone else? Anyone else? So, yes, ma'am. I know, right?
Yeah. Why doesn't he suffer with the rest of us?
Well, why don't you call and ask them? Well, look, I can't complain entirely. I mean, I've been to the Caribbean and Florida many times, too. In fact, I was just down there 3 weeks ago in Captiva, so I can't really complain, but... if I go every other year, you're right. He goes every year. And it's just, you know, one of the perks of being the, you know, top dog, I guess. But I'm going to tell him that, too. Yeah, yeah. Anyone else? Yeah, right. Anyone else? So listen, thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you for coming. Thanks for your questions. No, thank you. Thank you very much. I really mean that. So listen, I am going to set up shop here. I would be happy to sell you a book if you'd like to buy one. I'd be happy to sign it for you. Even if you don't buy a book, I have a newsletter list here. I have another book that's soon to be going in the works. And I plan to do some fun things with my newsletter list only and sort of share with folks how it's going, how the writing process is going, share a chapter before it ever goes to the publisher. So I promise you, no unwanted solicitations. Listen, it's a pain in the neck, actually, for me to get it out. So I probably only get a newsletter out once every 6 months, which is stupid. But nonetheless, you don't have to worry about too much spam. But even if you don't buy a book, please sign, give me your email address. I would love to add you to the list and keep you posted on that. So I'll be right here. Thank you again. Thanks.